Jesus. We meet again in these unusual circumstances, geographically and physically distant from one another, but conscious of the ties that bind, conscious that we who are many are one, bound together in a unity of spirit that transcends all the norms of this crazy world that is fast on its way out. Teach us to appreciate this unity of the spirit in which we share, to understand that each of us belongs to the other and that we individually and all collectively derive our sense of spiritual awareness from you as our head, Lord Jesus. In our worship this morning, may we each come to understand more clearly something of the Father's mercy, and in the process to more richly appreciate your sacrifice, Lord Jesus, the sacrifice that enabled our Father to make it all possible in his grace. So as we gather in our homes this morning, may we do so with gladness, rejoicing in the grace in which we stand. May we open the doors of our hearts and minds to make you welcome, Lord Jesus, in serious and meaningful fellowship. Help us give full attention and concentration in our worship so that we can receive instruction from the Spirit. Keep our minds from wandering. Preserve us from the distractions that abound when we have to share our fellowship like this via technology in our homes. We place before you this week our brother Mike, who last Thursday laid his mother to rest. We ask that you would bless Mike and the family this week as they come to grips with their loss. Give them the peace and the assurance that the promise of the resurrection brings. We also place before you this morning our prayer couple, Paul and Jill. We especially pray for you to protect their health in this current pandemic. We honour their steadfast service in the body of Christ over so many years, and the example they provide to us in their life in the Lord, their love for one another and for their brothers and sisters, their faith, their speech and their purity. Deal gently with them in your love, Father, we pray. Indeed, keep us all in your love. Keep us from stumbling. And if we do fall, may we not be crushed by it. Teach us to repent quickly and thoroughly and to move on, utterly confident in the forgiveness and the rehabilitation that you provide. In the meantime, equip us with everything necessary for doing your will. And may you continue to work in us what is pleasing to you through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Head, to whom be glory for ever and ever. Amen. Obviously, we've got a shortened agenda this morning. There'll be some announcements towards the end and a couple of lovely songs and hymns to conclude with. But we'll get straight into the message for this morning. A few years ago, five to be precise, I gave an exhortation at South Adelaide on the second coming of Christ, in which I made the point that there was, in my view, two clearly separate and distinct phases to what we traditionally, but mistakenly, all too often assume to be just the one big event. There were these two phases. And given our current end time circumstances, and at Paul's suggestion actually, because he spoke to me a few weeks ago and suggested I might speak on the matter again, I decided to take the opportunity to dust off what I said 5 years ago and update it to take into account a few more things that I've gleaned since. Now, because there's a number of new things that I want to say, I can't spend time going over all the background that I did 5 years ago, so let me get straight to the point. See if you remember this. The thing that started it off for me was the different wording that Jesus uses in two conversations that he had with his disciples about wedding banquets. In one of his parables, involving the wedding banquet in Matthew 25, the parable of the 10 virgins, you know, the 5 wise and 5 foolish. Jesus, the bridegroom, returns to go into a wedding banquet with the virgins, to take them in, like so. But while they're on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet. Now, in a similar parable, talking about the same sort of thing when he comes back, or a metaphor about a wedding banquet in Luke chapter 12, Jesus, the master, it's a different parable, if you like, or a different teaching, but it's about the same event. It's talking about his return. And Jesus, the master this time, not the bridegroom, but the master, comes to his guests while returning from a wedding banquet. So he comes not for his virgins to take them in, but he comes from a wedding banquet to his servants, like so. Luke chapter 12, be dressed, ready for service, keep your lamps burning like men waiting for their master to return from a wedding banquet. Now, that's a highly significant point of difference, one that started me off on a whole new train of thought and a whole new appreciation of what is involved in the second coming of Jesus. And after years of teasing this out further, I'm now utterly confident in maintaining that the second coming of Christ is in fact in 2 separate and distinct phases. First, Phase 1 is described by Paul in the well-known words of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, where he speaks of the Lord descending from heaven, the dead in Christ being raised, and those of us who are alive at the time being caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will ever be with the Lord. This is the occasion that Jesus spoke about in Luke chapter 17, and again in the Olivet prophecy in Matthew 24, when he said that one will be taken and the other left. You remember in Matthew there, 2 men will be in the field, one will be taken, the other left. 2 women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and the other left. It's also the occasion to which Jesus was referring when he related the parable of the 10 virgins. When the 5 prepared virgins went out to meet the bridegroom and went into the wedding banquet with him, leaving the 5 unprepared virgins to scramble around in the dark, vainly trying to get some oil for their lamps and get their act together. The purpose of this first phase of the second coming is to take the saints out of the world during the time of God's wrath that is coming on the earth during the great tribulation. For as Paul says to the Thessalonians, chapter 5, verse 9 of 1 Thessalonians, God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, which is going to happen with the inhabitants of the world, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. And this is a key passage in my conviction that the saints will be taken out of the world before the great tribulation, Daniel's time of trouble, such as never was. And there's the reference to that in Daniel chapter 12, a time of distress such as has never happened from the beginning of the world until now. But God did not appoint us to suffer that wrath. Jesus is going to come to take us out of the world before that final outpouring of God's wrath. So the saints living at the time are caught up, snatched away to safety, where they join the dead in Christ, now resurrected, to meet the Lord in the air and to go on to an undisclosed location, but somewhere safe from the final outpouring of God's wrath. There is then a gap period between Jesus coming for his saints in phase one, the often styled rapture, and I'll come to the terminology shortly, and Jesus coming again with his saints, bringing his saints with him this time in phase two, the glorious appearing to the world at large, which in my reading of prophecy, that'll be a gap of 7 years, during which time the marriage supper of the Lamb takes place between Christ and his bride, the church, at a safe, undisclosed location, maybe even in heaven itself, I have to say, but more about that later, while on earth there unfolds the great tribulation with the inhabitants of the world experiencing the final terrifying judgments of God. This is also what Jeremiah calls the time of Jacob's trouble. Because it will be the time when the remnant of natural Israel will be refined and brought finally to repentance and acceptance of Jesus as their Messiah. 2,000 years late, of course, but I guess better late than never. During this gap period, lots of things happen on the earth, not just to the Jews, but to the whole global population. Pretty much everything, in fact, described in Revelation, from chapter 6 of Revelation through to chapter 19. The whole lot, including the universal domination of a political and military power that Revelation calls the beast, supported by a religious system described as the false prophet, but also a massive preaching of the gospel led by God's two witnesses as they are described in Revelation 11, one of whom is undoubtedly Elijah, and the other, whom I maintain, is Moses. The sudden disappearance of so many believers at the time of the phase one rapture will spur many unbelievers who are left behind in the earth to repent and to turn to God. And these new believers will together constitute the great multitude that will come out of the great tribulation, albeit having been martyred by the beast, the Antichrist, in the process. The purpose of these judgments of God on earth during this seven-year gap period will be to have everyone then living on the earth make a decision one way or the other, either for Christ or for Antichrist. And God's judgments will intensify greatly in the last 3.5 years, the second half of this seven-year period, where the focus of the beast will be quite specifically on the persecution and elimination, if possible, of the nation of Israel and the Jewish people, wherever they are to be found, and the newly converted Christian believers. When the last of the seven bowl judgments of Revelation 16 is poured out, there will not be one fence sitter left on this earth. They will have declared themselves either for Team Christ or for Team Antichrist. All the great issues of life will be crystallized in this simple but stark choice that every human being will be forced to make. At the end of this interim period of 7 years, what we traditionally regard as the coming of Christ will take place, phase two of his coming, when the Lord himself will descend to the Mount of Olives, coming in the clouds of heaven, not for his bride this time, but this time with his bride, when his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, which will be split in two with a mighty earthquake, when every eye will see him. You may remember me using a PowerPoint slide, something like this, to depict the two stages of his coming, stage one, stage two. There you have stage one on the left there, as Jesus comes as a thief. But the scriptures also say he comes as lightning. Every eye will see him, but yet he comes as a thief. And some people, well, the idea of a thief, of course, the modus operandi is that no one sees a thief. So you get these contrasts. He comes as a bridegroom, two virgins in phase one, but as a master to servants in phase two. As welcome relief for the saints in phase one, that's what 2 Thessalonians points out, but as a flaming fire taking vengeance on his enemies, 2 Thessalonians 1. He comes to meet the saints in the air in 1 Thessalonians 4. He comes to stand on the Mount of Olives in Zechariah 14. He comes to be received with joy by his bride, Matthew 25. He comes to be received in grief by repentant Israel, Zechariah 12. Comes to bring with him the new Jerusalem coming down from God out of heaven in phase one. Comes to the old familiar city of Jerusalem in phase two to make it the new capital of the world. To a wedding banquet in phase one, from a wedding banquet, phase two. Before the marriage, phase one. After the marriage, phase two. For his bride, phase one. With his bride, phase two. And then I depicted the gap in between, like so. There you have part one, part two of Jesus coming, with that gap in between. I'm personally convinced that this two-phase model is sound exposition. And of course, I'd never insist on it, because I know a lot of people will disagree, and no one should ever insist on a specific interpretation of complex, unfulfilled prophecy. reasonable minds are entitled to differ. But I hold out this interpretation as, in my view, the most credible and likely approach. And it seems to me, as I've been trying to fit together all the pieces of the puzzle over the last few years, that the puzzle does actually come together if one uses this model. I know also that some Christadelphians will say, but the rapture, it's not a biblical word. It's not found in Scripture, that word rapture. And you know, they're right. The actual Greek word in 1 Thessalonians 4 is hapazo. So we could call phase one of Jesus' return the hapazo, if you like. But that would be a bit bizarre. It sounds a bit more like a Spanish dance than a term of Bible prophecy. Or we could call it, if we want to be technical about it, we could call it the snatching away or the carrying off, which is the literal English interpretation of the Greek hapazo, but that's a bit awkward. So I at least find it convenient to use the word rapture, which comes from the Latin Vulgate translation of the Greek verb in 1 Thessalonians 4, the Latin verb raptio, meaning to snatch or to carry away. And from which we get the English word rapture, which has become a bit of a romantic term, I suppose, now, and it's a bit awkward, but that's why I use the term, because it's simple. It's easier to talk about the rapture rather than the carrying off or the snatching away. That's all. So when people say the word rapture doesn't appear in the Bible, tell them that they have a choice. Several choices, actually. You can call it the hapazo, the snatching away, the caught upness, the carrying off, Second Coming Phase 1, or the rapture. I don't mind what we call it. It doesn't really matter. Call it what you like. But I call it the rapture because it's the simplest and most convenient. But don't be fooled that the concept is not found in Scripture, because it is. And we need to know about it and know the implications. Diagrammatically, we might express things like this to depict the two phases of Christ's coming. And I say this with a smile on my face, because I'm sure Carol's letting a sigh go at the moment. I had nothing much else to do during the week, so I tried to work on this little graphic and even put the cloud in there for the coming in phase one. He comes in the clouds of heaven and we're caught up there together. So you see, the period of the church is the period on the left-hand side down the bottom of the slide, 2,000 years of the church since Calvary and the resurrection. And then sometime soon we get phase one of his coming, when he comes for the church to snatch them up into the air, into the clouds, to take them away out of the earth for a period of 7 years, that seven-year period being called the tribulation. And I've marked the midpoint there, 3.5 years mid-tribulation, because big things happen there at the 3.5 year mark. The tribulation intensifies greatly during that period of time. But that's the tribulation period of 7 years. And then the second coming, Jesus coming with the church, with his saints, in glory, in probably what we traditionally consider to be the second coming. But there it's phase two, the second coming with the church, after which the millennium goes on for, of course, the 1,000 years. Now, look, why am I mentioning all this? You might say, well, look, this is all good. This is all good exposition. But why should we be mentioning it all on a Sunday morning? Well, we all agree that we're living in momentous times. And to be sure, lots of generations have said that before, but there is one thing that all Bible students and students of prophecy would readily agree on. There is one thing of which we can all be absolutely certain. We are now much closer to the return of Jesus, to resurrection and judgment and the establishment of the kingdom of God on earth. We are much, much closer right now than the early Christadelphians were at the time of Elpis Israel, or than our parents were in the dramatic days of the First and Second World Wars. We're much closer than we were in the 1967 Six-Day War, or the 9/11 calamity in 2001, or even the GFC in 2008. Of one thing we can be absolutely certain: our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. This is a fact. It is therefore incumbent on us to consider the widest possible range of serious, credible views on prophecy. while we still have time, so that we can best be prepared for what might shortly be about to confront us. The views I put forward this morning are of particular importance because if we accept the two-phase aspect of Jesus' return, firstly, coming for his saints to take them out of the great tribulation, and secondly, coming with his saints to put an end to the tribulation, then the great consequence of that is that there is absolutely nothing that needs to happen before Jesus returns to gather his saints. Absolutely nothing. This is one of the things that attracts me to the views I presently hold, because this particular view of prophecy has given good reason for people of every generation to believe that Jesus would return in their lifetime. There's no need to look for Russia first coming down to attack Israel before Jesus returns. No need to ask whether things are bad enough for Jesus to return, whether it can be said that men's hearts are failing them for fear yet, or whether things still have to get worse. With the views I put forward this morning, people of every generation since Jesus ascended into heaven have had every reason to expect Jesus to return at any moment in their lifetime. And so with us. Jesus could very well come today. As I read Bible prophecy, Jesus could very well come to snatch us away before we've had lunch today. But, and there is a but. It seems to me he will only snatch away the faithful. Only those who are ready and waiting for him and who love his appearing. The fact of Scripture is that some will be left behind. Those left behind will enter the great tribulation, and given the message of Revelation in particular, no one, believe me, no one wants to just drift into that period of history simply because they were unprepared for phase one. It seems to me that a lot of what has been happening over the last decade or two are divine hints. Shots across the bow, as it were, warnings of the sorts of things that are in store for the world in what will be the most destructive and terrifying period of time the world has ever experienced. So disastrous, so destructive, that Jesus himself said that if those days were not shortened, then no one would survive. But they will be shortened to a period of 7 years' tribulation, of progressively intensifying desperation, the last 3.5 in particular being styled the Great Tribulation. You know, I hear talk from time to time about the world of coronavirus being a time of trouble such as never was. We've never had a time like this. I hear people saying, you know, I think men's hearts are beginning to fail them for fear. You know, it's not so. It's not. Yeah, these are tough times, I suppose, for some people. But really, if people think this is a time of trouble such as never was, they really ain't seen nothing yet. Men's hearts are not literally failing them for fear, but one day very soon, I believe they will be literally failing them for fear. It's one of the things of prophecy, I think, so often, a lot of prophecy that we regard as being, oh, that must be symbolic, I think is actually literal. God's made it so simple for us. The first four of the seven seals of Revelation in chapter 6, and remember, I think chapter 6 through to chapter 19, all happen in a period of a seven-year period, the tribulation period, still to come. And the first four of the seven seals, in my view, happen on the earth one after the other in quick succession, immediately after phase one, the rapture. And they refer, in these seals, they refer to up to 25% of the world's population being killed by sword, famine and plague, or war, starvation and pandemics, to modernise the language. Four horsemen here are given power over a fourth of the earth to kill by sword, famine and plague, and by the wild beasts of the earth. That final reference to the wild beasts of the earth actually made me think during the week of the Chinese wet markets, but no, it couldn't be, could it? Could it? Well, in any event, this passage looks like a prediction of the Earth's current population reducing within a very short space of time, from its current 7.8 billion to about 5.8, 5.9 billion or thereabouts in a very short space of time. All, I suggest, within the first year or so of the seven-year period of the tribulation. And if you find that hard to believe, oh, that can't be literally true. Well, bear in mind that in the plague of the 17th century, the Black Death, I think it was the 17th century, wasn't it, or earlier, one in three, a full one-third of the population of Europe was culled in that pandemic. A disaster of that scale can and will happen again, from my reading of prophecy, very soon. There is no reason why we shouldn't take this literally. Coronavirus is the very gentlest of warnings, almost a caress of what can happen, and most likely will happen again on a scale many thousands of times greater very soon. Coronavirus is the gentlest of divine hints of what is coming on the earth, and perhaps a very literal hint, because this is the other thing that I think happens with the interpretation of prophecy. God gives us warnings, many warnings. He says, this is what it's going to be like. Here's a gentle hint. Here's another gentle hint. And I think this happens all over the place. When we come to the first of the seven trumpet judgments in Revelation chapter 8, that predicts that one third of the earth's forests and foliage will be burned up. First angel sounded his trumpet, and there came hail and fire mixed with blood, and it was hurled down upon the earth. A third of the earth was burned up, a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. And you say, well, hail and fire mixed with blood's got to be symbolic. Does it? And a third of the earth was burned up. Perhaps the recent summer bushfires were just the gentlest warning of what can happen and will happen on a global scale very shortly. The second trumpet judgment of Revelation 8 refers to a third of the earth's oceans being turned into blood. And it says the second angel sounded, something like a huge mountain all ablaze was thrown into the sea. Well, that can't be literal. Well, maybe it's talking about some great meteor or something from outer space hurling into the Pacific or something. Could happen. Anyway, after that happens, a third of the sea turns into blood. A third of the living creatures in the sea die, and a third of the ships are destroyed. Now, you might say, well, that's got to be symbolic, but look, there's precedent for this. There's a precedent for waters being turned into blood. That's what God did to the Egyptians at the beginning of their 10 plagues. And no one actually among us will question whether Moses did actually turn the waters of the Nile into blood. Can you imagine the trauma when one third of the living creatures in the world's oceans are destroyed almost overnight? And yet we've had little warnings of that all the way along with what we're doing to the sea and the environment. Is basically God saying, well, let's just hurry the process along. That's where you're headed. You're headed to killing everything in the sea. Let's get this thing over with. The third trumpet judgment speaks of the fresh water supplies of the earth being polluted and many people dying as a result. The fourth trumpet judgment, following immediately on, tells of an immediate reversal of global warming, if you like, on a truly breathtaking scale. One third of the sun's warming rays will suddenly be blocked. One third of the day will suddenly be without light. Well, there's one way of fixing your global warming pretty quickly. Darkness. Zephaniah talks about that day will be a darkness of gloom, of clouds and of thick darkness. Zephaniah, have a look at it. Again, I think he's talking about this sort of thing, this very thing. And then the fifth trumpet prophesies a global plague of locust-type creatures with scorpion-type stings that will torture the people of the world for 5 months. There it is. Locusts came down upon the earth and were given power like that of scorpions to torture men for 5 months. During those days, men will seek death, but they will not find it. They will long to die, but death will elude them. We have Joel, of course, talking about that plague of locusts in his prophecy. It had no doubt an immediate application. Why won't it have an application very shortly to come, and a literal application at that? And a plague of locusts did literally happen, of course, in the days of Moses. Again, why not again? A plague of locust-like creatures with scorpion-like stings, told not to harm what's left of the grass and the trees, but just to torture and torment human beings. I've got no doubt there is no reason not to take this literally. No reason. The sixth trumpet judgment in the latter part of Revelation chapter 9 predicts a massive outbreak, to me, of what seems to be indicative of nuclear warfare. Originating in and around the river Euphrates in the territory of Iran and Iraq, but ultimately killing one third of mankind, as it says. Thus again, in quick order, reducing the world's population, this time from, we're down already down to 5.8, 5.9 billion, reducing it down to, let's say, 3.9 billion or thereabouts. Sixth angel sounded, the four angels had been bound at the great river Euphrates, were released to kill a third of mankind. Now that can certainly happen in nuclear warfare. The number of the troops, I don't understand that 200 million, amazing, but a third of mankind was killed by the three plagues of fire, smoke and sulfur. It just almost smells like nuclear warfare to me. And so by now, what at the start of the period of tribulation will have been a global population of 7.8 billion, which is today's population, it will have been halved approximately to about 3.9 billion by a combination of utterly devastating pandemic, famine, uncontrolled fire, pollution, plague, and nuclear warfare. And all this within the first half of the seven-year-long time of trouble such as never was. And still, the world will not repent. Still, it will not come to its senses. And I say the world at large because during the first 3.5 years of the seven-year tribulation, God will still ensure that the gospel will continue to be preached. In fact, just as hundreds of millions of unbelieving, God-hating people will be killed during the tribulation period, it appears that hundreds of thousands of others will have been so affected by the sudden miraculous disappearance of the raptured saints just prior to the beginning of the tribulation, they will repent and proclaim the gospel to others during the first half of the tribulation. They will suffer persecution from their godless neighbours. But one of the great mysteries of life is that it is in times of greatest persecution that the gospel flourishes. And these new believers are the ones described in these terms in Revelation 7, just after John sees a vision of a great multitude from every nation and tribe and people and language holding palm branches in their hands and crying out, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they? Where did they come from?" "Sir, you know," I answered. And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." Of course, all this raises the question as to whether those Christians, so-called, who are not raptured, will be able to repent and be saved during the period of the tribulation. My reading of things is that it will still be possible. Given the seeming endless dimensions of God's grace, but any salvation during the tribulation period is probably going to be through or via martyrdom one way or the other. If not during the first phase of the tribulation, then certainly during the second, more intense phase of the final 3.5 years, the great tribulation, so-called, under the domination of the beast and the false prophet. As the prophecies of that period in the second half of Revelation testify, those who are saved during this period, the tribulation saints, let's call them, they will overcome by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, because they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. It seems to me that there is an inevitability about all of this, that there will be no other way of salvation during this period, for as chapter 13 states, chapter 13 from verse 9, if anyone is to go into captivity he will go. If anyone is to be killed with the sword he will be killed. This calls for patient endurance and faithfulness on part of the tribulation saints. And then right at the end in chapter 20, we are even given details of the terrible form of execution to be employed by the beast, the false prophet, and their acolytes during the great tribulation. John saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge, and I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony for Jesus and because of the word of God. These are the ones who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or their hands. At the end of the period, the end of the 7-year period, they come to life and they reign with Christ 1,000 years, joining those pre-tribulation saints so fortunate to have been caught up in phase one. So this is another point I want to make this morning. Yes, there is probably such a thing as getting one's act together in the nick of time, because God's grace is just so amazing. There is such a thing, I think, as being better late for salvation than never. There may even be such a thing as deathbed repentance. But if we are not among the real believers, the genuine faithful who are prepared, ready and raptured in phase one, taken out of the world before God's final judgments, then salvation, if indeed it is still possible, may only be possible via a fiery trial, snatched from the fire, as Jude describes it. Salvation almost certainly incurring martyrdom. And I wouldn't wish that experience on anyone. I think maybe this is what Paul had in mind when he wrote to the Corinthians in those puzzling words of 1 Corinthians chapter 3. The day of the Lord will bring a man's work to light. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. I just put it out there as a possibility and as a warning. There are no lengths to which God will not go to save a person whom he wants, even if that involves salvation by fire. We should just pray that in our case, none of us will be so hard-hearted and so thick-headed as to give God no other option, because things will very rapidly go from very bad to utterly traumatic for the world's population in the blink of an eye. On my reading of Latter-day Prophecy, the sealed judgments of Revelation chapters 6, 7 and 8 and the sequence of the seven trumpet judgments in chapters 8 and 9 will occupy the first 3.5 years of the full 7-year tribulation period. Think, wow, if that's only 3.5 years, what will happen in the last 3.5? And while the first 3.5 years will be a traumatic time for the world in a physical sense, as I've just outlined, the beast of Revelation will have signed a peace treaty with the nation of Israel at the beginning of the 7-year period. So the nation of Israel will not suffer any more than any other nation in this first phase of general global tribulation. I don't want to refer to this in detail, but Daniel 9 talks about this, the great 70 weeks prophecy of Daniel, the beast confirming a covenant with many for 1-7, but in the middle of the 7 he puts an end to sacrifice and offering. That raises another issue as to whether or not the Jews will build a temple, and we won't go into that at the moment, but in the middle of the 7, final 7 years, he will put an end to it. He will set up an abomination that causes desolation, which I think will be he will set himself up in the temple of God, calling himself to be God, as Paul says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and demand that the world worship him. He will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him on the beast. Lots to say about Daniel 9. We certainly can't even touch on that today. It's a great place to start if you're looking at all these wonderful things about prophecies of the time of the end. So as I've mentioned, during this first phase of the tribulation, much of the world's population will actually repent and turn to Christ. And while they will face severe opposition for their beliefs, the world will generally be so preoccupied with the physical and geographical chaos in the natural world in the first half of the tribulation that most new believers will maybe probably survive the first half of the seven-year tribulation period. But after that first 3.5 years, things change dramatically for the worse. First, the beast will break its peace treaty with Israel and enter upon the fiercest, most intense persecution of the state of Israel and the natural Jewish people since the beginning of time. The last 3.5 years of this seven-year period will be what Jeremiah calls the time of Jacob's trouble specifically, and Revelation, the great tribulation. The beast given power during this particular time to utter proud words and blasphemies. Power to make war against the saints and to conquer them, both natural and spiritual Israel. All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all those whose names have not been written in the book of life. It will be the final 3.5 year period of the kingdoms of men, a time when natural Israel will be refined with fire and driven to finally accept Jesus as their Messiah. As we find in passages such as Ezekiel 20 and Zechariah 12, we haven't got time to go into today, but you can look at that. Look at those passages there. Ezekiel 20 talking about God taking note of Israel as they pass under my rod, and I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. I will purge you of the rebels, purge you of those who revolt and rebel against me. Zechariah 12 talking about Israel, natural Israel, looking to me, the one they have pierced. They will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child and grieve bitterly for him as a one grieves for a firstborn son. Natural Israel being refined in the fires of tribulation in the latter half of this seven-year period. Spiritual Israel as well. Gentile believers will suffer grievously during this final 3.5 years. How so? Well, the beast will enforce global financial rules so that no one will be able to buy or sell or trade unless they have the mark of the beast tattooed either on their right hand or on their forehead. The implications are obvious. Serve the beast or serve God. Serve the beast or starve. Serve the beast or be driven out of civilization to fend for yourselves. Who knows? Maybe even, as it says in Hebrews 11, maybe even like the faithful of old, to wander about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, mistreated, wandering in deserts and mountains, in caves and holes in the ground. Maybe that is what awaits the tribulation saints. Aren't you glad for phase one? The rapture. The purpose of the great tribulation will be to get people off the fence, to make a choice one way or the other, Christ or Antichrist, and it will most certainly achieve its purpose. Devastatingly, brutally so. The beast will demand that all the people on earth worship him as God. He will demand the whole world bow down to an utterly amazing, technologically spiffy image that the false prophet will set up on behalf of the beast. And Revelation 13 talks about it there. The false prophet ordered the inhabitants of the earth to set up an image in honour of the beast. He was given power to breathe breath to the image of the beast so that it could speak. I don't know what quite that could mean, but no doubt we'll find out one day. And it caused all who refused to worship the image to be killed. You know, I said history repeats itself. God warns us again and again. It'll be very much like the old story in Daniel chapter 3 of Nebuchadnezzar setting up his massive golden image and then throwing into the fiery furnace anyone who would not bow down and worship the image. History repeating itself. God's given us that many warnings. And this seems to be a feature of Bible prophecies. The things that will be are so often the things that have been already. albeit on a much, much smaller scale. Believers, mostly new believers, of course, in the first phase of the tribulation, will be faced with the same choice that confronted Daniel's three friends. Things will be that stark. Revelation says that during those final, or Revelation 11 says that during those final 3.5 years, God will send his two witnesses, two special ambassadors, to make one last miraculous plea for the people of Israel and indeed the world at large to turn to God. It's clear that Elijah is one of the two witnesses, and we've always believed that and understood it. He's actually specifically mentioned in Malachi as well. I think it's also clear, though, that Moses is the other, the law and the prophets, making one last plea to natural Israel and indeed to the whole world. Moses and Elijah. Just as they encouraged Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration before his great tribulation, so they come again to the world, to Israel specifically, but indeed to the world at large. And Revelation 11 talks about their witness. I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, 3.5 years. The last 3.5 years of the 7-year tribulation, clothed in sackcloth. If anyone tries to harm them, fire will come from their mouth and devour their enemies. Ooh, just like Elijah back in the day. These men have power to shut up the sky so that it will not rain during the time they are prophesying. That's Elijah. And they have power to turn the waters into blood and to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they want. That's Moses. And while this is going on, the angels will pour out the 7 final bowls of God's wrath recorded in Revelation 16. That first final bowl will involve ugly and painful sores breaking out on people who have received the mark of the beast and who worship his image. The second is poured out on the sea, the whole of which this time turns into blood, with the consequence that every living creature in the sea will die. So that couldn't last for long. Thankfully, it won't last for long. We're in the last 3.5 years. Remember, this is a period of time during which no flesh would be saved unless the time is shortened, and it will be shortened. The third bowl of God's wrath will be poured out on the earth's fresh water supplies, turning them all into blood. And I can only imagine the desperation of the world's engineers to purify and filter a bare minimum supply just to sustain human life. Or if all the waters, or maybe we'll have a pill or something, we don't have to drink water at that time. I don't know. But it will be a desperate time indeed. And the fourth bowl relates to the sun, which was darkened under the trumpet judgments, but it will now produce excessive energy to scorch the earth's population with intense heat. And that we can understand given our recent record heat summers. I wonder what the weatherman will say in those days. The fifth bowl is poured out on the throne of the beast, on head office, if you will. Everyone in the kingdom of the beast, all who worship the beast and have the mark of the beast, will be enveloped in complete darkness. Note there is a distinction being made here between those who follow the beast and those who follow Christ. Does that remind you of the plagues against Egypt, which towards the end, God drew the distinction between his people who are left, who are being refined with terrible fires, and the beast, or the Egyptians in that case? The darkness affects the kingdom of the beast. It's just like the Exodus. History repeating itself. And we get caught up with all these things and wonder about the symbology of it all. So much of this stuff happened literally in the past. God's saying, I gave you a hint, And I've made it simple for you. So much of prophecy, so much of it is literal. You don't have to read your history books and go through it. Oh, you can. It's all helpful. And yeah, look, there's some truth in that as well. But for those of you who, we're not students of prophecy, well, just read it. Read it. Read the Bible. History repeats itself. It's interesting to note all the similarities here between these 7 bowls of God's wrath and the 10 plagues on Egypt. This fifth bowl judgment is actually the equivalent of the 9th pl- plague against Egypt, the plague of darkness. And look, there's no exact correlation here, but a clear pattern of comparison is observable nevertheless. We're getting near the end. The sixth bowl gathers or involves the gathering to the Middle East of all the armies of the world in preparation for the final showdown of the armies of with the armies of heaven. And then the seventh and final bowl of God's wrath brings everything to a conclusion. And the seventh angel pours out his bowl into the air. Out of the temple of heaven comes a loud voice from the throne saying, "It is done." Then there came flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, and a severe earthquake. No earthquake like it has ever occurred since man has been on earth. So tremendous was the quake. Every island fled away and the mountains could not be found. From the sky, huge hailstones of about 100 pounds each fell upon men. Couldn't be literal. Why not? They cursed God because of the plague of hail. Because the plague was so terrible, the unbelieving in the world, in the kingdom of the beast, will still not repent. But it's too late now because it is done. It is over. And we know how the story ends. Jesus wins. And Revelation 19 and 20 tell us how. Chapters 21 and 22 take us forward into the millennium and beyond. So what is the message for us in all this? Let me simply conclude this morning with four simple propositions. Four simple statements that we need to carry with us in whatever time we have left to us. And it may not be much time at all. First, let me say, there is absolutely nothing that needs to happen between now and Jesus coming to collect his saints. There's nothing that needs to happen between now and the rapture or the hapazo or the snatching away, the carrying off. Absolutely nothing. No more prophecy needs to be fulfilled. The world doesn't have to get worse as some imagine. Oh, it will get worse, much, much worse. But not until after Jesus comes for his saints to take them out of the world altogether, because they have not been appointed to suffer the divine wrath of the last days that will be poured out in seven horrendous years of divine judgment. And if we miss it, if we are left behind because we're not fair dinkum and we really aren't, you know, we're Christians in name only, and we never pray or read, or we're just hangers on. If we miss this, then we and our unbelieving or otherwise unfaithful friends and family and neighbours will face 7 years of the greatest natural upheavals, political machinations, human suffering, and religious persecution in the history of planet Earth. Keeping faith in that world will almost certainly lead to martyrdom. And no one would knowingly, willingly, just drift into the period of the Great Tribulation, because although a great number of the world's population will turn to God during that time, their salvation will almost certainly be via the path of martyrdom, and we would not wish that on anyone. So proposition two. While there is probably such a thing as getting one's act together in the nick of time, being better late for salvation than never, and while there may even be such a thing as deathbed repentance, the fact is, if we are not among the faithful who are prepared, ready and raptured, taken out of the world before God's final judgments, if we are still on the earth during the time of the Great Tribulation, then salvation, if indeed it is still possible, may only be possible via a fiery trial entailing martyrdom. Proposition three. While the current pandemic is not so good, and the resulting lockdown so frustrating and inconvenient for all of us in so many ways, what we are currently experiencing is not, repeat, not a time of trouble such as never was. It is not men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things that are coming on the earth, because Proposition 3, this old world, it ain't seen nothing yet. So much of prophecy is literal, simple and literal. More of it than we might ever have expected. Prophecy isn't one of those things that, oh, it's just for students of prophecy. It's for ordinary men and women who will take the time to read it and be warned and encouraged by it. This latest crisis is probably no more than just a shot across the bow to remind us of how quickly things in our comfortable little world can deteriorate, and of the grave danger we are in if we and our friends, family, neighbours and colleagues remain unprepared. It's not as though this coronavirus epidemic is the only divine warning we've ever had either. Remember our recent bushfire season from hell, following on from several of the hottest summers on record? Seems like a lifetime away now, doesn't it? The unprecedented pollution of our oceans and waterways. Have you seen pictures of the plastic waste out there in the Pacific just sloshing around, covering areas larger than the size of many countries? We're trying to kill off the sea. We're trying to do it. The uncontrolled flight of refugees across the world. Let's not forget that the Syrian crisis still rages, despite those quaint, plaintive calls from the Secretary General of the United Nations to let's have a ceasefire while we get coronavirus under control. Yeah, right. International terrorism. Terrorists don't care about social distancing. Massive financial crises, the GFC in 2008, the current global cash splash. The numbers are truly eye-watering. I mean, how many zeros are there in a trillion anyway? God warns us in so many ways. History repeating itself. Same stuff happening again and again. And finally, statement 4. Let's be mindful that there is a blessing for the one who reads the words of prophecy drawn together as they are in Revelation, the apocalypse. There's a blessing for the one who hears what God has given to us and who takes to heart what is written in it, for the time is near. The time has always been near for saints throughout the ages, because our Lord could very literally come to take us as his collective bride on any day, at any time. There is never anything that still needs to happen before Jesus comes back. Things can move at such a breathtaking pace, as we have seen. So the Revelation concludes with one further blessing reserved for those who keep the prophecy of this book. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. How do we keep the words of the prophecy of this book? That there in Revelation chapter 3 is the simplest and best answer, I reckon. It's that well-known, oft-quoted passage demanding deep personal reflection. The promise to the church in Laodicea, which is perhaps doubly appropriate because some people identify the state of Laodicea, the last of the seven churches, with the state of the church just before Jesus returns. Lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, blissfully unaware that in reality it is wretched, pitiful, poor, blind and naked. And the antidote to this malaise, the one recommended, indeed commanded by the Lord himself, is the one that has rung out throughout the centuries and it still stands out today. It's one there that different people will interpret and apply in different ways in our own personal circumstances, but one that everyone must surely consider critical in assessing the genuineness of their faith. I stand at the door and knock. In commenting on this very passage, Brother Alfred Norris, in his book Apocalypse for Every Man, paints a memorable word picture that I'd like to leave with you this morning. This is a description that challenges the quality of our fellowship, and these words also bring us so appropriately to the table of our Lord. And in commenting on this very passage, Adrian says, Our Lord will break down no doors. On the other hand, to open up to him is to accept the consequences. He is no bringer of a message to hand it over and leave us to our leisure. He comes in expecting to stay. He will be neither postman nor rent collector. The door must be flung wide to receive him. No dusty, disused drawing room must be unlocked to receive him with distant gentility while he sits on the edge of quaint, uncomfortable chairs and makes polite and meaningless conversation until it is time to go. Now, he must be asked to stay and eat with us. Let's give thanks for the bread. Lord Jesus, we've heard you knocking. We open up to you now. We have opened up before, but sometimes we've been less than hospitable. We've made you wait. Truth be told, we've fed you scraps, fast food and unhealthy snacks more often than not. We've made you share your time with various other unworthy guests whom we should never have had around. Forgive us for our cold, unsociable ways. We've treated you badly. We want this time to be different. We're inviting you in for a one-on-one. We want to talk about good stuff. We want to share things with you that we haven't shared before. We want to get to know you so much better than we've known you before. And we're going to open up to you like never before. We're going to be honest with you, really honest, sharing our worries, our concerns, even our occasional doubts and unworthy thoughts, because we know you can handle it all and that you can help. You want to help. You are our only help. Thank you, Father, for not abandoning us to the fearful destiny of this world. Thank you for giving us your Son, for sharing him with us. We promise, Father, to treat him like a king. The king he already is, in fact. We promise to take him in and make him feel perfectly at home. Thank you, Father. Amen. Let's then feast with Jesus in our homes and in our hearts. Let's give thanks for the wine. No meal with you, Lord, is complete without sharing the wine of the new covenant. We recognize in this wine, symbol of your blood, which in turn reminds us of your life poured out in sacrifice to take us in and to include us in your great act of love, to include us in your body. As a result, we have been brought under the life-giving, life-affirming, life-energizing bond of the new covenant that promises to transform us from within. Such love demands the best we have to give. And just as you have taken us in to be a part of your body, so we want to take you into ourselves so that you can make your home inside us. So as our hymn says, as we linger here, Lord, a while over supper, as we linger over wine in fellowship and in deep communion with you today, with thankful hearts to worship thee, out of the riches of thy grace, bestow thy blessing full and free. And in return, we promise to maintain an open door policy with you. We promise that for you it will always be open house with us, so that 7 whole days, not just 1 in 7, we might praise you. We also promise to bring you the cream of our hearts in solid, meaningful fellowship for those 7 whole days, and not just some cheap, scrappy, watered-down version, because for you, Lord, with you, in you, and with you in us, only the best will do. Amen. This is the sweet wine of the liberating new covenant that has been sealed in our Saviour's blood. I heard the voice of Jesus say, this hymn challenges us, doesn't it, to listen to, it challenges us to get into a state of spiritual mindfulness. Let's see if we can hear the voice of Jesus as we sing this hymn together, hymn 330.
Thank you.
So a few announcements for the week. As I indicated earlier, our prayer persons for the week are Paul and Jill. Please bear them in mind, especially in this time when they, of all people, are very much locked away in their homes from the virus. Also, a special announcement, Carol is going into St Andrew's Hospital this Thursday for an operation, and she'll be in hospital for 4 or 5 days, certainly over next weekend. I know she would appreciate your prayers for a successful operation and a speedy recovery. That's Carol later this week. Bible class this Wednesday, God willing. Bible class will continue via Zoom, the usual Zoom thing. So, as usual, look for Peter's email invitation and click on the link that he provides in that email a bit before 8 p.m. starting time. Everyone seems to be enjoying themselves on Bible class these nights. And I think this week we'll be moving into James chapter 3. And I think Mike is preparing or has prepared some thought starters to guide our discussion. Next Sunday, God willing, if we're still here, as I said, if we're still around and we haven't been taken out of this world before, Lucy will be giving the exhortation from the hall here. It'll be transmitted via the usual live stream with John helping at the back so ably. Richard Provis is to chair, so we'll have Richard and Lucy down here at the hall next week. So tune in next Sunday at 11 a.m. as per the usual live stream address, southvid.com. Collections, don't forget, of course, that let's not neglect ecclesial finances during these unusual times. Contributions can be made via EFT, and the details about that are in the announcements that I'll email to people later today or this evening. So please keep all these people and plans in your prayers this week. We're going to finish with two fabulous songs from Praise the Lord. Well, one's Praise the Lord, one's Worship. First one, Lord Jesus Christ, we honour, praise and worship you, after which we'll have a final prayer. And then, just to conclude, round it all off from the worship book, Christ is Returning, Worship 38. So firstly, Lord Jesus Christ, we honour, praise and worship you. Thanks, John.
Thank you.
to the dawning of your new day, the new heavens and the new earth and the new Jerusalem that you have promised. We know what kind of people we ought to be. We ought to live holy and godly lives as we look forward to that day and speed its coming. May we all therefore be prepared for that day, expectant, eagerly anticipating our gathering together in the Lord in the clouds of heaven. Father, as we wait and occupy wisely, we pray for that glorious day. We pray that nothing may stop us from doing what needs to be done and from being the sort of people that we ought to be. That self-will may not stop us from obeying you as we ought. That fear may not stop us from taking the stand that we ought to take. That laziness may not stop us from giving the service that we ought to give. That discouragement may not sabotage our hope and cause us to give up or pack it in. That lack of perseverance might not stop us from running the race to the finishing line. Instead, grant us such purity and clarity of thought, such wisdom of mind, such strength of will, such devotion of heart, and such hospitable fellowship of and towards and in the Spirit that we might not even want to do anything except those things that please you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord and the strength that he supplies. Amen.